the people who will sing it on the video on demand. So I'm Father Joachim Lally, quote retired fallist, and be happy to be with you this evening on the great banquet parable. So let us begin with prayer. We begin as we begin all the important things in our lives, not just in our own name, but always in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of wisdom, open our minds to that message of love that you want to share with us through this parable, so that the kernel of its truth may sink in and take root and be part of the transformation of our very lives. Let my words not get in the way of your truth. I pray this in the name and in the power of Jesus, your Son and our brother, forever and ever.
Amen.
In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, so welcome again. We're going to be dealing with the great banquet. And so this is found, you see on the pages there, some of the references. It's one of the parables of reversal. These all parables portray metaphorically the polar reversal which the kingdom advent demands. So there's six reversal parables: the Good Samaritan, the rich man in Nazareth, the Pharisee and the publican, lowest seat at the banquet, the great banquet, and the prodigal son. And they all deal with this reversal, which you don't think is going to happen. Like the Pharisee and the publican. You think the Pharisee is going to be the one going home, you know, blessed. And it turns out the publican is the one that's called to be honored by God. And the Good Samaritan, it's the Samaritan who's the enemy who becomes the hero in the story. So all these are, and the prodigal son, the one that leaves home, comes out, and because of the welcoming and forgiving heart of the Father, becomes the one celebrated at the banquet. So all of these things are reversal and are meant to have the listeners perk up and listen and ask, what's going on? Why is this happening? You know. So we're going to look at the two versions, three versions, really, the Gospel of Matthew 22, 1-10, and the Gospel of Luke 14, 16-24. And we'll just make a passing reference to the Apocryphal Gospel of the Gospel of Thomas, which is not one of the four Gospels. So, this book by Crossan says it's difficult to decide for sure whether Matthew and Luke both found this parable in Q. Q is a source, kind of an unknown source, from which some of the evangelists drew their material. Mainly, I think it was Matthew and Luke. They drew most of the material from Mark. So whether it belongs to Q, to the special and independent sources, we don't know. Many commentators believe that Jesus told the parable once and the Gospels reused it with changes. So this is the question. Is it two parables or one? You can kind of look at that as we go along. But first of all, let's look at the difference between the two parables. Matthew 1:22 is 1-10. It's called the wedding banquet, okay? And in Matthew, it's not called the wedding banquet. Jesus began to address them once more using the parables. The reign of God may be likened to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the wedding, but they refused to come. A second time he sent other servants, saying, "Tell those who were invited, see, I have my dinner prepared. My bullocks and corn-fed cattle are killed. Everything is ready. Come to the feast." Some ignored the invitation, went their way. One to his farm, another to his business. The rest laid hold of the servants, insulted them, and killed them. At this, the king grew furious and sent his army to destroy those murderers and burn their city. Then he said to his servants, "The banquet is ready, but those who were invited were unfit to come. That is why you must go out into the byroads and invite to the wedding anyone you come upon. The servants then went out into the byroads and rounded up everyone they met, bad as well as good. This filled the wedding hall with banqueters. Okay, that's 1 through 10. There are other couple of verses there that are frequently tied on to this, but really don't belong to this. It's a separate parable about the wedding garment. So we'll go into that a little later. Okay? Now, let's compare that to Luke. All right? And this is Luke 14, 16 to 24. All right? Jesus responded, "A man was giving a large dinner, and he invited many. At dinner time, he sent his servants to say to those invited, 'Come along, everything is ready now.' But they began to excuse themselves, one and all. The first one said to the servant, 'I bought some land and must go out and inspect it. Please excuse me.' Another said, 'I bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going out to test them. Please excuse me.' A third said, 'I'm newly married, so I cannot come.'" Doesn't say why, does it? "The servant returned, reporting all this to his master. The master of the house grew angry at the account. He said to his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring to the poor and the crippled, the blind and the lame.' 'Your order has been carried out, my lord, and there's still room.' The master then said to the servant, 'Go out into the highways and along the hedgerows and force them to come in. I want my house to be full. But I tell you that not one of those invited shall taste a morsel of my dinner.'" So, very different versions of this parable. And the question is, were they using the same parable, or are they two different parables? We shall see as we go along. Okay. Now, the main difficulty is that Matthew's version has been considerably changed as compared with Luke's. Matthew has made 2 major additions. First addition is added on at the end of the originally independent parable of the wedding garment. Remember when they said this guy comes in and doesn't have the wedding garment on and they throw him out into the fire and brimstone, right? And then made some minor adjustments within the Great Supper in preparation for this appendix. One realizes that immediately that this inclusion breaks the logical unity of the parable. The host had just gathered guests off the streets without any warning in 22:9-10, and yet he now expects instant wedding garments and sartorial elegance in 22:11-13? I don't think so. You know, it doesn't make sense. The two, often in the Sunday liturgies, you will have those two together. You notice that? And it's just a shock, like, come to this banquet, and then all of a sudden, this welcoming, king notices somebody that's not dressed properly, and so they throw them out. It's like, wait a minute, something is not consistent here. So it's really a separate parable. Okay, Kelly's beautiful work here. The fancying up. 3 versions of this parable. Now the second edition that Matthew puts in is he's deliberately inserted allusions to the immediately preceding parable of the wicked husbandman from 21:33-46 into the parable of the Great Supper. And we'll notice that both involve killing others. Okay? They didn't get what they wanted, so they killed the people. It's not a very good sign of good news. It's obvious that 22:6-7 just cited could not have been part of the original parable. Why such violence in declining a dinner invitation? And are we ready to imagine, really to imagine, the sending of a punitive expedition while the dinner grows cold on the table? Huh? It's like, what's going on here? They don't come in, and so you send out people to kill them? Stop the dinner and everything else? It's like, this doesn't make sense. Matthew's purpose is clear. He has allegorized the parable into an image of the history of salvation as he sees it. And by his addition of this 11-13, he has actualized in it application to the internal tensions within the Matthean community, the community of Matthew. Those originally invited did not come. It was supposed to be Israel, huh? That's the allegory. And so others, the Gentiles, were brought in to the banquet, but they must still be worthy of this invitation. Okay, see, they get into this idea of worthiness. And that's where the garment comes in, because it's a symbol of, are you fit? Are you worthy? Are you prepared? Okay. Now we'll see a very different kind of attitude in Luke. Matthew, as we know, tends to be the one who exaggerates, and he tends to be threatening and warning. You'll notice that the only real gospel of the Last Judgment is found in which evangelist?
Matthew.
Matthew what?
25.
Matthew 25, exactly. That's Matthew for you. He's got to threaten. He's got to say, well, if you don't come through, we're going to throw you into the everlasting fire, you know. You don't hear Luke saying that. Luke does not use that kind of language. And, of course, Mark doesn't either, and especially John doesn't, because John is the mystic. He's the evangelist that talks about God as love, right? Very different. That's why they call the synoptics, you know, the three of the same nature, synoptic, and different from the other evangelists of John. They're very different. You ever read those Gospels? The Gospel of John is so different than the Gospel of John hardly has any parables at all. Okay? Not like the first three. So if you have any questions along the way, please let me know. So let's go into Luke's version. Who's going to read this for us? All right, Bob, yeah.
Luke's version, not as heavy-handed as Matthew's example. Double sending of the servants. Go out to the streets and lanes of the city, and go out to the highways and hedges. These could represent the mission to Israel and to the Gentiles.
Okay, let's just say, the streets and lanes of the city, these would be the people who were sort of in, the in crowd. They were the Jews, okay? Now, the people on the highways and hedges, they're the outsiders. They lived outside the city, most likely they wouldn't get to the temple. And that was the kind of cutting off point if you're good or bad, if you went to the temple, like today going to Mass, right? So anyway, it's the sending out into these two different areas. Okay, go ahead.
Luke has moralized the parable. It is precisely the poor and maimed and blind and lame who are to be invited. But Jesus said in 14:12-14, not to invite the rich, but to invite the poor, in order to be rewarded by God, not man. The parable, on the other hand, tells a story in which the rich are first invited, decline the invitation, and the poor are then invited in second place. In summary, the basic parable has been allegorized by Matthew into an image of the history of salvation and has been moralized by Luke into an example of rather doubtful ethical greatness.
Okay, so why is this last part about doubtful ethical greatness? Well, I want to see what you say first. Luke is being inconsistent here. If you have your Bibles with you, I don't know if you do or not, but look up the first two verses before 14:16-24. Look up 14 and 15. Look up 12 to 15. Who wants to read that? Luke chapter 14, verses 12 to 15.
12 to 15?
Yeah, 12, starting 12, going down to 15.
Then he said to the host who invited him, "When you hold a lunch or dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your wealthy neighbors, in case they may invite you back and you have repayment. Rather, when you hold a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. Blessed indeed will you be because of their inability to repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous."
Okay. Let's see. Marge, you want to pick up a few Bibles back there and we'll give those people that don't have them, please? Okay, so in Luke 14:12, it says very clearly, whenever you give a lunch or dinner, do not invite your friends or brothers or relatives or wealthy neighbors. They might invite you in return and thus repay you. No. When you have a reception, invite beggars and the crippled, the lame and the blind. You should be pleased that they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid in the resurrection of the just. And so he says this very clearly, right? Do not invite the wealthy and invite the poor. But what does he do in the very next verse, in 16, verse 16? What does he say? It says, Jesus, a man was giving a large dinner and invited many. Okay? And so he goes out to those people who, it's presumed that they are people of means. They didn't invite beggars in those days. You had to be of a certain class. So it's just the opposite of what he had just said. He said, don't invite him. And here in this parable, he's giving Jesus saying about this parable about inviting the people of means. So that's why it says it's rather doubtful ethical greatness here. It's not consistent. Does that make sense? So I often tell people, when you have a dinner, have a Luke 14 dinner. Invite people who won't invite you back, you know? The poor, the nobodies, the lonely, the, you know? That's not what we generally do. We invite people who think like we do and have about the same bank account we do, and we kind of stay in our own social class, and it's just kind of a social ritual we have, right? That's not what Luke 14:12 says. Okay. Now, Crossan writes that there's one common problem in both Matthew and Luke. The story presumes that the guests knew in advance the date of the banquet and that the servants are sent out to inform the guests that all is now ready. Okay, so I guess we need to put ourselves in that Mideastern mentality around the first century because, you know, they didn't have microwaves and they didn't have freezers and, you know, whenever they had a banquet, they had to go to a lot of work and a lot of trouble and took a long time. They had to roast the pig over the fire, whatever, it took days or whatever. So they didn't quite know when it would be. So they didn't send out an invitation and say, at 5 o'clock on Friday, they know you're going to have this dinner and we want you to be there. No. They just said, okay, around the 3rd, 4th, or 5th of June, we're going to have this feast, all right? We're going to invite you. Be ready. That was the general invitation. And then they sent out the servants to say, hey, it's now ready. Come. So they expected them to sort of be ready so that they could leave without too much trouble. All right? So Matthew 22:3 says, send his servants to call those who were invited. And Luke 14 says, invited many. At the time for the banquet, he sent his servants to say to those who had been invited, come, for all is now ready. I remember going to a lot of different meals in the Dominican Republic over the last 25 years. I've been leading these missions for 25 years, since 1990, yeah. And you'd go to someone's house and they'd say, hey, would you stay for dinner? ¿Quiere cenar con nosotros? You know, you want to stay for dinner? Oh, fine, you know. Well, 4 hours later, you know, you might start eating, you know. They have to go out and kill the chicken. No, they only have three or four in the yard, so they'll kill couple of them for you since you're a guest. And then they have to start a fire, and they have to over kindling wood, and then they'll start boiling the rice. And I mean, it doesn't take place in a minute. I mean, believe me, I remember when I first started going down there in 1984, I could not find a fast food restaurant in the whole country. No such thing as a McDonald's or KFC or whatever, you know? So, you know, you just couldn't get a quick meal. It was just a different mentality, you know? Now they do have those monsters down there, those fast food things, don't they? Okay. This makes their refusal at this time quite inexplicable, and their refusals and excuses become rather facetious. This increases their culpability, and it fits very well with the allegorization process as an attack on Israel, which had long been invited and balked at the very moment of the banquet. You see how there's parables are coded language, like I've explained before. You know, and that's why some people, it goes in one ear and out the other. You know, it's written in a different style, and a lot of times it's not consistent. And so we don't take the time to dig into them and see, what's this saying to me? You know. So when you think of a invitation to a banquet, what do you think of?
It's going to be real fancy, white tablecloths, people serving you coffee, and salad and all these different entrees.
It's not going to be hot dogs and potato chips, right? It's like, was it last year I went out, they had a quote-unquote banquet for those who do prison ministry out in Ionia at the Bellamy Creek prison, which I go out every month and have masses. And so I thought, well, you know, they're wanting to show some gratitude for the people that go out and serve the prisoners and everything, you know, and that's nice of them, you know. So I pictured this banquet, you know, like you say, with white tablecloths and everything, you know. Well, you get there, and it takes a long time to get in, as usual. They got to, you know, have to take your shoes and socks off, and they got to look under your feet and make sure you don't have any drugs, and go through the metal detector, and go through whatever you've got. And it's a hassle. You do this every time. You kind of get used to it. So then you get in, and what happens? Nice potato chips and hot dogs and, you know, a little maybe cupcakes or something, you know. I mean, really, this is a banquet, you know. So anyway, I understand they don't have a big budget. But you would think they would say, wait a minute, these people are coming in all year long on their own, paying their own gasoline, taking their own time. Least we can do is really have a nice dinner, right? No, don't count on it.
It's the government. Or does the prison, the prison itself puts it out?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, they have a shoestring to put it on with, let me tell you. So, I mean, and not that you, if they told you ahead of time, well, it's going to be hot dogs and potato chips. All right, well, fine, okay. Then you can decide. But when they use the word banquet, what do you think? It might be a little upper class, right? Well, wrong. Let's look at some difference between Matthew and Luke in the parable of the great banquet. Okay, who wants to read here? All right.
Some differences between Matthew and Luke in this parable of the great banquet. Number one, in Luke, the story starts with a certain man, but in Matthew, is the king. Two, in Luke, it is a great supper, but in Matthew, it is a wedding banquet. Three, in Luke, there is one invitation, but in Matthew, there are two. Four, in Luke, the invited guests make excuses, but in Matthew, they refuse and turn violent. Five, in Luke, the invited guests are passed by, but in Matthew, they are destroyed. Six, Matthew's parable is harsher than Luke's, but then it comes later in Jesus' ministry in Matthew, at a time when he was facing severe opposition from the Jewish leaders. Are there two separate parables? Commentators differ.
Okay. Anybody have an opinion? You think they're two separate ones, or it's the same parable? Did Jesus tell two separate parables, or did he tell one, and then each evangelist kind of adapted it as they saw fit?
I would say Jesus told one, and then, you know, how many years later were these written? Because they didn't have tape recorders or video cameras.
No.
So this is how people remembered, or, you know, and then they put their own spin on it.
That's right. Yeah. It could have been the year 70 or 80 before the first Gospels were written, you know. And Paul started writing around 50, I think. So, you know, you got 30, 40 years. And who can remember 30, 40 years ago? You know, like I'm having this anniversary, my 50th anniversary of priesthood a week from Friday, and I've been going through photographs, you know. 50 years worth of photographs, I'm telling you. I've got thousands of them, and so many memories. And I look in so many different ways, you know, when I was 50 years younger, right? Oh my gosh, it's like, is that me, you know? And so it's like, and when you don't write anything down, I can't tell you, okay, I remember that took place on July 1st or whatever. No, I mean, it's just, it's a photo, and you don't remember the details, right? So I tend to agree with Bob. I think that, you know, the evangelist told it in their own style for their different reasons. See, Matthew was writing to the Jewish converts. He were writing to people who were steeped in the tradition of the Jewish law. Okay? He was trying to convince them, we'll see later, that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the judge, the king. All right? Luke is writing to Gentiles, people who are not Jews. He's got a whole different flavor. Very different. Matthew's trying to get a point across, and he's threatening if you don't get it. Matthew is the one that is like the parent. It's driving, the father's driving the car and on the highway, and the kids are acting up in the back seat on this long trip. And he says, if you don't pipe down back there, I'm going to stop this car and get out and put you both on the roof and tie a rope around you, and we'll see how you like that. Okay? Now, what kid is going to really believe their father is going to stop the car and rope them to the car? No? But do they pipe down? Yeah. Because...
Not mine.
Sound... No, not sure.
I stopped the car.
Something, I'm going to stop this car and let you out and you can walk, right? That's another one.
So what was going on politically during the time Matthew was writing and when Luke was writing? I mean... Was there a lot of gang wars going on during Matthew? And do you know what I'm saying? That would influence his more violent presentation as opposed to Luke.
Well, I think that Matthew was facing a lot of opposition. He was trying to convince the Jewish converts that this is the real Messiah, you know. And they expected the Messiah to be a king, all right? This is not so much the attitude of the Gentiles. They didn't have this messianic expectation that the Jewish converts had. So Matthew felt like he had to warn them and threaten them and speak harsh language for them to get it. But Matthew is the one, we'll get later, is the one that has the Matthew 25, the judgment. The sheep will be separated from the goats, and the goats will go into eternal fire and brimstone, and on and on and on. You know. If you like fire and brimstone, read Matthew, all right? Okay, now we'll just take a brief look at the apocryphal Gospel of Thomas. Now, these are the main points of Thomas. The host suddenly decided on a banquet and sends out his servants with all things in preparation. Quote, a man had guest friends, and when he had prepared the dinner, he sent his servant to invite them. We're asked to imagine a host who rather imprudently plans a sudden dinner, starts the preparation, and sends out the sudden invitation for that very day. It's an utterly possible situation. People do that. But what happens? The guests are usually busy. Yeah, if you'd have let me know sooner, I could have, you know, watered my garden or started shearing the sheep. But no, I'm busy now. The second one is, what do you do with the prepared food? So you got problems. Moralization, primarily immoral condemnation of the invited guests. It's a warning not to let material cares distract one from the invitation to respond. There is no trace of Luke's positive moral, no mention of the poor. So, I don't know personally much about the apocryphal gospels. I haven't really studied them. Anybody studied the apocryphal? You know, they picked up the four evangelists, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But there were others that they left out. The gospel of Matthew, I think there was one from Mary Magdalene, and I don't know. But different ones that didn't fit in with the criteria they wanted.
Oh, I was just going to ask you why those were omitted, why they chose.
Well, they picked ones that they figured were more consistent with each other and not too far out. The Gospel of Thomas, I think, has Jesus as the little boy making little clay pigeons, you know, in the dirt, and then blessing them, and they fly away. You know, stuff like that, you know. A little far-fetched, you know. But it's not, as Roar says, he thinks they did a good job of picking the four evangelists, you know. Okay. So a little more on Thomas. In this version of the Gospel of Thomas, Crossan, John Dominic Crossan, a scripture scholar, writes that there's a very simple and extremely possible story of situational reversal. A man decides on a sudden dinner that very day and sends out his servants to his friends as the dinner is being prepared. Because of the lack of warning, each one finds he has a perfectly reasonable excuse. The result, a meal prepared and a table empty. The host's reaction is to send the servant out to get anyone he can. There is no implication that he is looking for riffraff for the poor. You know, see? The others said, go out into the highways and byways, then you know you're looking for the poor then. Crossan writes that this is a situation of total reversal. The invited are absent, the uninvited are present. As parable, it provokes their response to the kingdom's arrival as radical and absolute reversal of their closed human situation. So the parable is supposed to shake you up and say, hey, what's going on? It's supposed to kind of wake you up out of your complacency. What's this mean about a banquet? What's going on here? What's the story? What's Jesus trying to get across? And usually Jesus spoke in parables because there were people out there ready to get him. They were looking for any word he would use that would be considered heresy, that would not be according to the Jewish law. They watched him to see if he cured anybody on the Sabbath, which he wasn't supposed to do, whether he cleaned his hands before he went to eat, and who he ate with and who he didn't. You ever have people always watching you to see if you make a mistake? Huh? How comfortable do you feel, you know? If you're speaking the correct English, or your table is set just perfectly with all the right silverware in the right place and everything. Do you want to invite people over to check out if you're according to whoever the expert is in table setting? Or you just want to invite people over that will take it as it is?
Mm-hmm. Isn't that a big thing with Jews, conservative Jews, how the table is set? I saw that in Religion and Ethics on public television.
Yeah.
Some Christians converted to Judaism. Uh-huh. That was very important, how they set the table.
Oh, yeah, the Seder meal is just, you know, you have rituals to form, and you do this first, and you light this candle, and then you do that, and you break the bread or whatever. But you don't go out of order. It's got to be this way, you know. It's a ritual. I mean, look at the Mass. The Mass has its parts, you know, the opening, the Lord have mercy, and then the readings, and, you know, the offertory. You don't put the communion first. You have the readings first, you know. But Jesus was being scrutinized. They wanted to catch him because they hated him. Why did they hate him so much?
That's
correct.
Pardon? That's correct.
Say more about that.
Well, he challenged the established order, I guess. Uh-huh. Because he was unconventional and he associated with the wrong kind of people.
That's right. They're wrong kind of people, right? His right kind of people. There were laws saying who you could go into what house to eat. Very, very strict about not going into certain homes that were homes of sinners. And there were public categories of sinners. You know, the sinners were
prostitute.
They were the tax collectors. They were people that did usury. And they were shepherds. Shepherds were in the public category of sinners. And that, who did the angel first appear to announce Jesus' birth? The dirty shepherds. They were considered unclean because they stayed with the sheep, and like Pope Francis said, you know, if you want to go with the sheep, you got to smell like the sheep. You know, get dirty, get with them, you know. And and besides that, they didn't go to temple. They were out. They had to stay out with the flock all the time, you know. It was a 24/7 operation. So therefore, they were considered unclean. They were not allowed in the temple. None of those categories were. And you were not allowed to eat with them. Jesus broke these rules. He upset the apple cart. And he paid the price. That's what happened. He spoke the truth to power out of love and took the consequence, which was the crucifixion. This man must die, right? Okay. Okay, so let's have a little break in your small groups here. There's eight of you, so we could have a let's get all your names. What's your name now?
Jim.
Jim and?
Darlene.
And Marge and Bob. Could you all get together? Maybe Bob and Marge get over here and get with Jim here. And then the four of y'all, Carl and Norma and?
Tolly.
Mm-hmm. And? Ed. All right. Used to remind me. Ed used to be my name.
Okay.
Before I joined the monastery.
Edward.
Okay.
Are you Edward or Edwin?
Edward.
Yeah, that was my dad's name, Edward. Yeah.
Mine too.
All right. There we go. Okay. So, however you want to do it, you want to pull chairs. You can have.
Going around that way.
Okay. Some people. Okay, if you just sit here, Edward, that'll be fine. So look at the questions. Do you identify more with Matthew's, Luke's, or Thomas's version of the great banquet parable? And why? Does the symbolism of a banquet possibly refer to an invitation to all of us to go into deeper union with God, others, and ourselves? Do we have excuses? What might they be? All right. Make sure you know everybody, right? Everybody introduce themselves.
Hello,
Carl.
Michelle.
Sorry. I'm James. Sorry. Nobody get me. Tell me if I don't do this.
Okay, so you identify with Luke.
I identify more with Luke. I think, and he was supposed to be the physician, you know.
Exactly.
And I think he has more compassion, more sensitive maybe.
I'm probably naive. I'm not a big
I guess I can't. I just find it hard to understand, and totally in our society today, people's answer to problems is to whack somebody or kill them or something like that, like Matthew.
I picked up on that.
Talking about the Jews who were
Under before, nobody's sure, so they go all over the grave. And then in the next verse, they're beating you up because you're not dressed right.
I know he covers, but my take on it, I kind of understand where Matthew was coming from, you never know when you're going to die.
You know, you never know when you're going to be called, but when that happens, you better be ready. So I never took it as a flaw or an inconsistency. I just thought, well, it is what it is. You know, it sounds harsh, but you're supposed to be ready. You know, like that one thing about you don't know when the thief is going to come in the middle of the night.
I don't really like Matthew, but I
be prepared anyway. So anyway, I'm surprised, I guess.
Because the Romans were very violent.
At the, you know, what I heard here was there's apparently these experts that went to this.
They were trying to convince the Jews.
Verses taken out.
Would that be logical?
No. But I think he was more of a politician than the other two.
Okay.
We had a priest on the cross. Yes. I was going to ask, I don't know who Thomas was speaking to.
I'm willing to bet there's 10 experts, 10 opinions.
Or what was he, did he think his audience was?
I don't know.
We had a priest that
the people who refused
Marius by the Walsh.
Go out and kill them.
Oh, yeah, Aaron Burgess.
Who's this king supposed to be? Because first you read that and think,
he used to go out and he got in a lot of trouble. With the Holy Spirit.
Wouldn't a dinner get cold?
He would go out to
your house, burning the city. And,
and
I mean,
the parishioners, said,
the practicality of time, you know, you're going out
drunks and whoever else.
We're on Verner and Fort Street. You know, there's a 3-year cycle of beatings.
What do you think Jesus would be preaching?
He really was a good guy.
Yeah. 3-year cycle, do you know?
And in that way, I identify with Thomas.
Yeah, I mean, I don't remember when, but
I hear it somewhere, I've heard it, the white garment,
and it sounds very familiar, but sad to say, I don't question anything, but I am now. I study the parables regardless of what they represent, and so I like this kingdom. Because I want to say I take it for granted,
the arrival of the kingdom.
I hear it, and I don't want to say it's in one ear, not the other.
The inclusion of the poor or not.
Or of anybody that would consider an outsider.
Because of the, to get to the, in that sense,
it'd be easier to think, in my simple way of thinking, which is more attractive to those kinds of ideas of presenting the parable itself or the story.
He was talking about 50 years, sometimes I can't remember 1 minute.
Luke, certainly. Easier.
Well, I don't think, Luke, there was no.
Thomas doesn't do it.
Of the people who refused to come.
I'm still trying to figure out the meaning here as parable.
It provokes the response to the kingdom's arrival.
Yeah, they're inviting.
And absolutely
it's moralized a parable
their
on page 3, where
situation.
The poor and the maimed and the blind, are to be invited.
Right.
But to invite the poor.
At the bottom there.
Luke says. The end, for I tell you, none of those men who were invited to feast my dinner.
Yes.
Didn't
so
tell
that,
you're meaning
no,
the
own
social
that's
comfortable
it.
With that.
That's it. The shepherds stay with the shepherds.
Do you ever get into discussion with the Pharisees,
or
Jehovah's Witnesses, or
come to your door and want to
discuss. Exactly. But isn't that true?
So much.
I had an uncle who used to say, "You want to be happy."
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. I shouldn't do this, but I do ask because it's a dollar that I like to ask questions like this. Well, how come there's an inconsistency? How come the Bible doesn't condemn slavery?
Wishing up there.
And they've got an answer, but
Mary within the church.
So,
yes.
Got forbidden cross racial marriage or something.
Exactly.
Or you feel uncomfortable.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So I think
leads to a lot of symbolism there.
Isn't there?
Exclusion and phobias. And you can feed that, can't
you? Totally.
All three versions.
Well, I think with us, as we're older than the younger generation, I think it's we can adjust to it. You know, the differences. And it's coming at us from every angle. And we're trying to be acceptable, you know, of people that are different than us. But the younger people don't have as many hang-ups of, you know, it has to be a certain way. And that probably is good. It's roughly a lot of people, you know, the differences and what's going on. Because
you mean our generation?
Yeah. Because they're like our parents' generation. You know, everybody stayed home. The mothers stayed home. The fathers went to work. There was that.
So is that why there's so many kids not even being involved in the church?
See somebody you know.
Yeah, I think that's part of it. I think that is.
Well, I think if they read a book or so
over here, maybe they're not.
Hell and damnation, you're going to be caught.
Do you think that resonates with me?
I don't think it does.
It does. No, not today.
No, that's what I'm saying.
No.
It doesn't impact them at all.
No.
Don't
think.
Root kind of thing. Sometimes I try.
It's amazing.
There's somebody looking.
It really is, but, you know, the tradition and the catechism and things like that.
Young people sort of have the idea.
Yeah.
Feels good.
Well, I'm single, so a lot of times
later is better. I'll try it out now. If it works, great. If not,
we'll
just live together. We'll just have sex. And, oh, gee, that was wonderful. But
because we have get-togethers at our house, just Christmas, Easter, Thanksgiving, birthdays. We do invite the relatives, same. But we don't go out and say, well, how about so-and-so was all by himself? We don't do that. We should, you know. I think that's one of the lessons.
They got five kids living together.
Right.
No marriage. No intention of
it.
But there's no church either.
There's no church, yeah.
I remember about the servant.
It's very interesting. I mean, it's just, and
start somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like everything to the wind, you know, or if anything takes me, I will go. And yet you can get the other, and you can't go out of your box. So that's, you know, trying to put that together, and it's a very confusing world today. It is.
Is that an excuse?
I was asking if this is
not my
part, one of the three-year cycles.
Is that an excuse?
Readings?
Do we have excuses?
Uh-huh.
They're young.
Oh, yeah.
They're not getting married. Even though a lot of them
have
unions with children, and they stay together their whole lives.
Yeah.
You have a good homily on
it. I think the thing to do, it's so very hard for children. There's so much divorce, and it's not just one divorce, it's a couple divorces.
Yes, exactly.
And then they got stepbrothers over here and stepbrothers over there. And
two mothers.
Yes, and being raised, it's all over the place. And so nothing is, there's not that stability. That's why I feel sorry for the kids that are coming from those stepbrothers.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very hard.
It is very hard.
I have a granddaughter that's age 13, it's very hard.
Mm-hmm.
Which one do you think today's kids would identify more with, Matthew, Luke, or Thomas?
Going to church,
Sunday Mass, listening to the
Well, I don't think Matthew, because they just laugh at that. Right. You know, they just think this is ridiculous.
Yeah, they
expect us to believe
after
that.
A while,
you know, it's like Father was saying, you know, they're in the car, they're going to, you know, get thrown up.
The Bible.
They just say, come on.
Yeah, exactly.
That's how we don't even go to church, because we know that's not true.
They roll their eyes and keep moving.
Here's this week.
Yeah, maybe a combination between all three of them.
But when you start reading this, it's like one or the other. God, there's stuff before the gospel started,
right,
and
exactly.
There's stuff after, and that leads into the next one. I get an entirely different perspective.
There's no social grace involved in Thomas.
And that's always something I've noticed. You know,
we're throwing a big party.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Kegs, somebody else. I mean, I don't have any problems if somebody calls and says, hey, listen, get together, let's go. Okay, if I'm free, I'm on board. Well, that's it, if we're free, because, you know, not being prepared, sometimes it's like, oh, I've been working in the yard all day. It's a lot of formality.
You must be invited. And you don't have the social grace to say yes, even though it's short notice. Why should I settle for second class or riffraff?
When was the Bible transformed? There's a degree of formality involved in being invited.
Like, should there be formality to be invited into the church, into the sacraments, into
the faith? Isn't it a message?
I guess,
if you don't receive the message,
doing something that bizarre.
Yeah.
There's that excitement. So I guess, like I said,
I've drawn on props in Hollywood.
I mean, there could be probably heightened emotions in the physical act of killing.
Oh, sure.
because.
But how do you get to that where you would want to do that?
But how do we make it
we
more exciting about God?
Yeah.
How is that done?
What's recorded?
Well, the irony is these things.
You were on your own at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
Like they're doing it.
Their leader was gone.
Yes, they are. That's what
they do. Yeah, that's
true.
Yeah.
It's
right.
Quite interesting.
So.
With Luke.
Go with Luke too?
What excuses did we come up with?
Excuses that we turned down the invitation to the banquet? I'm too busy, I'm tired, I'd rather go to a Tigers game.
All the time for lack of exercise.
Yeah. There you go.
It's too cold.
It's too cold.
Wet.
Yeah.
Too cold.
Too hot.
Too wet. Too hot.
I just ate. Or
God calling us into a deeper walk with Him. It's like, oh,
anyway,
that doesn't
yeah,
look comfortable.
Carl Walden and
I think
it's
you
a
know.
Commitment.
She's trying to make a nice
hey,
Christmas.
It's a commitment.
He's kind of
when
a
you
radical,
make a commitment like that,
yeah.
Then do you have to say no to some of the other things that you're
so
doing
upset, you know,
that would interfere?
Feasting
well, yeah.
That, you know, right off the street now.
And I think that that's part of the thing with kids,
what she
too.
Does, she gets
not just kids, but with me sometimes, too.
$10 bills, and she says, no, you can stay.
You know,
you're going to have this $10 bill. And I'll take the
$10
bill.
It's about a commitment.
I saw it.
I'm saying
it's a humor.
It's hard to say no.
Sometimes it is, and I think that was, that's what
okay,
makes
I
us
I wonder
human,
if we
too.
Can get back together. It's 8 o'clock.
Well, thank you for joining us.
Yeah.
If you get a chance, Sunday night at,
yeah.
I don't know, it's 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
Are you watching the program ED?
I haven't been, though.
No, I haven't.
Do you like
it's
it?
Been, I've been really impressed. I don't know how accurate it is or how much the church endorses it.
Yeah.
But I've been really impressed.
Well, it's good entertainment. I don't know how scripturally based it is.
But I don't think the church has condemned it,
has
it?
No, it wouldn't condemn anything like that. It would just, suggest that, you take into account that this is Hollywood doing it and, have an open mind, but don't take it as, absolute fact, It's a lot of imagination there. So let me just get back to you in terms of the development of the New Testament canon. C-A-N-O-N is the name of the establishment of the four Gospels. Canon means the norm. And you have, of course, canon of the Mass, right? That's part of the Mass. The canon of the Mass is from the preface on. And then you have canon law, right? Which we studied for 4 years in the seminary, all the rules of the church and what can be done and what can't, and punishments and all that kind of stuff. So, but anyway, it says that they weren't really established as four Gospels until the turn of the fifth century. So that'd be the 400-something, that's when they said, okay, now we can pretty well be sure that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John have the authentic gospel stories. But they're all different, you know? It's like, you think if Jesus wanted to get one story down, it would just be one, right? But you have four different versions. So it's like Jesus saying, okay, I like diversity, right? You know, it doesn't have to be just one certain way. And that's why Rohr says that because of all this dispute about the word, what's the right word, a lot of religions dispute over what's the word, what is the correct original Greek or Hebrew or whatever, that because there's 30,000 different denominations of Christian religions, okay, all of them claiming to be the one true church, right? Because of this, Jesus himself became the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, okay? So it's like we can get in a lot of trouble with words, disputing this, that, and the other. But Jesus came to show us the Word, which is the Word of love, the way he loved us, okay? All right. So... okay, so who won? Did Luke or Matthew win? Anybody have any opinions on that? You didn't discuss that?
Well, we did, yes. Excuse me, I don't need to talk so much. I felt like a take from the three.
Right.
I mean, I can't, you know, each one, and I was keeping in mind, too, as you mentioned, and I think Bob did, too, that it was, they were... like you pointed out, that they were written for Matthew's for the Jews and Luke for the Gentiles, but I think they all have, we can take a valid point from all of them.
Right. I've been looking into lately this whole issue of, did the four evangelists actually know Jesus personally? What do you think?
Well, the Gospel of Matthew, isn't that? I always thought that was supposed to be Matthew, the tax collector, but that's not. No,
that's not true, no.
No.
A lot of times people would write later and claim the name of one of the apostles to give them authenticity. Okay? So they say that none of the four evangelists, particularly John, John lived way after the death of Jesus. He wrote around the year 90, maybe up as much as the year 100. And so... usually you think they were eyewitnesses, but they weren't. You know?
I used to think that, and this probably would embarrass me, I used to think that John was the apostle that Jesus loved, but this is written, like you say, way beyond Jesus on the earth.
You see, we really don't know the actual names of the ones who wrote these Gospels. We just know that... they use these names to give credit, you know, like some of the, in the school of Monet or the school of Van Gogh or whatever, they would tick upon, they'd sign a painting and they'd put Monet's name down. Well, he was a student of Monet, and so it looked very much like Monet's style, but only the expert could really tell whether it was Monet or the school of Monet. And so a lot of the evangelists, you know, would take the name of, you know, one of these famous apostles just to gain a certain amount of credibility, you know, and authenticity.
May I ask, I don't know if they say the Acts of the Apostles, they credit that to Luke?
Luke.
And then how, may I ask, are you able to answer why they think it was...
Well, because it is so similar to the Gospel of Luke.
Oh.
It's you can tell it's the same author.
The same style.
Just by the same style and everything, you know.
Okay, thank you.
And in many ways, the Acts of the Apostles could be another gospel. It's just, what's the distinguish between the Acts of the Apostles and the gospel stories, you know? There's a lot of things in there about the early Christians, so. But it's a fascinating... study, you know, the study of the scriptures. Okay, let's, any, now, but I think you were, weren't you discussing whether you thought it was one gospel or one parable or two? Did you have any conclusions? Let's have a vote of hands. How many think it was one? It was one parable that Jesus taught, and these were adaptations. That's what I think. Anyway. Yeah, right. That's settled. Okay. Now we'll.
What do you think, Father?
I think it was one parable. I think it was. Matthew took considerable leeway. And added his fire and brimstone in there and the killing of all the messengers and everything. But that was just Matthew. So, you just don't take Matthew too literally, that's all. Okay. Now, overall themes of the parables of Matthew and Luke. This is from this great book, Parables of the Kingdom by Mary Ann Getty Sullivan. She's a scripture scholar for over 30 years. And really knows her stuff.
Father, that that croissant that you're that's from another book that you got your sources.
This is the Parables of the Kingdom, Jesus and the Use of Parables in the Synoptic Tradition, Mary Ann Getty Sullivan. Okay, and then this other one was John Dominic Crossan in Parables, The Challenge of the Historical Jesus. You know. And Mary Ann Getty Sullivan, who has taught over 30 years in Catholic colleges and seminaries, scripture, she goes more into this book in comparing the themes of the various evangelists. What's their theme? What do you see running through their writings? Okay? So we're going to look at that now.
Oh, that was right on the first page. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Had that all in there.
Yeah, right. Okay. So, in order to better understand the differences, let's look at the overall themes. All right. Jesus is the Christ. This is Matthew. Jesus is the Christ proclaiming the coming of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus is the obedient Son of God. Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus has authority as Son of Man over the kingdom of God. It will come to judge the world. Matthew 25 is the judge, right? And yet, you read in Scripture, I think it's even Matthew that says, judge not, you shall not be judged. And so I think, this is the debate among Scripture scholars, whether or not Matthew 25 is a parable or not. You know, Jesus gathering everyone for the final judgment and separating the sheep from the goats, and you... Now, it of course brings out, I was hungry and you gave me to eat, I was thirsty and you gave me to drink, you know, and identification of Christ with the poor, you know. One author says that it really was talking about the way Gentiles treat the Jewish converts. It was narrowing it down a bit, you know, that's what Matthew was really talking about here, because that was his interest, you know, how the Jewish converts were treated.
Excuse me, Father, Did you think that was a parable?
I think it was a parable. I've seen other scripture scholars that say, no, it wasn't, or maybe it was, but I'm reading more and more scripture scholars that say it was a parable. In other words, it's not supposed to be taken literally word for word. God separates the sheep from the goats and sends the goats to hell and all that. You know, that's put the fear of God into a lot of people, and it's colored a lot of people's image of God so that they're more afraid of God than they love God. But you don't have that scene in the other Gospels, do you? It's just in God. It's just in Matthew. So that's why you got to understand, where is Matthew coming from? So this is his themes. He wants Jesus to be the Son, the Judge, and so on. Matthew demonstrates special familiarity with the Jewish Scriptures, showing that the Scriptures are fulfilled in Jesus, that they support his claims to be the Messiah. Yeah, that's what his main point. He wanted to convince the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah. Righteousness. The law, then, is not an objective or static reality, but a relationship, a covenant between God and people. Trust, confidence, fidelity are all characteristics of God's relationship with people. Okay, so if you take that and you juxtapose that with the Matthew 25, it's like, wow, it's just not much of a relationship there. It's like, either you did what I wanted you to do or go to hell, you know? And that doesn't seem to be in very coherent with the other themes. Bye-bye. Okay, who's going to read this, the 4 and 5?
Themes of Matthew continue. 4. Church and synagogue. The distinction and even animosity between church and synagogue are more pronounced in Matthew than in any other synoptic gospels. Special areas of tension, judgment, true righteousness, leadership, and wisdom. Number 5. Jesus is the authoritarian teacher. According to Matthew, Jesus set up a dichotomy between his interpretation of the law and that of the Pharisees, teaching, you have heard, but I say.
You remember that, those parts in the gospel? You have heard this, but I say, you know. Jesus is saying, I am the lawgiver. That's what the Jews wanted. They wanted authority. They wanted, you know, Moses and the law and, you know. They didn't want any guesswork. They wanted everything definite, you know. So Matthew comes across as Jesus is the authoritative teacher.
Father, what does synoptic mean again?
It means the same eye. Optic, of course, is the optical, O-P-T-I-C. And syn, S-Y-N, is the word in Greek for alike. Like the same vision, same vision.
Okay.
A synonym, you know, like the other word, synonym. Okay. We continue with the themes of Matthew 6 and 7. Leadership. For Matthew, the scribes, and especially the Pharisees, are false leaders. Peter and the other apostles and disciples are the true leaders of the new Israel. Where does this famous quote come from that's in the St. Peter's Basilica and the cupola right around over the altar, the baldacchino in the St. Peter's, that has those famous words, tu es Petrus. You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, right? That's the foundation of the papacy. You are Peter, and you're the Pope, you're the boss, right? Now, there are scripture scholars who are saying, wait a minute, the use of the word, you are Peter, which means rock, because it was Cephas before, right? And Jesus changed it to Cephas, to Peter. Petrus, which means rock. But there's a difference between Petrus and Petra, the masculine, the feminine. And so there are people that are saying, okay, you are rocky, calling Peter rocky. That's what the literal meaning of the word in Greek, rocky, Petrus. And upon this, and then it uses another gender for the noun of Petri. You are Peter, and upon this rock. In English, it sounds the same. But if you go back to the original language, it's like, you are this rocky person, and upon this faith community, I will build my church. So it's not so much an individual person. This is the interpretation of some scripture scholars, okay? And so it's like, okay, if that's the only scripture quotation they have for that, maybe they need to look at another way of perhaps governing the church. You know, who knows what they're saying.
Because in another part of scripture, Jesus calls Peter a stumbling block,
yeah,
which
right.
is the same thing.
This rocky stone, right?
Right.
It's a rocky stone, this unstable stone. That's what Peter was. I mean, look at Peter. He was impetuous Peter. You put your foot in your mouth, Peter. He was always saying something and thinking about it later, what he said. Let me come to you on this water, Jesus, and I'm going to step out and walk on this water, and he starts falling. And Peter is very impetuous, you know. Lord, if everybody else denies you, I will not deny you, you know. He comes up, and what happens? He's the one that denies. So Peter is a very strong person. But he's very impetuous. And so, but Peter still is chosen by Jesus as the leader of the apostles. Okay? Matthew paints a more positive picture of the disciples than the other evangelists, especially Mark. Okay? Judgment. Matthew is most apocalyptic of all the Gospels. Jesus is the arbiter and judge. Once again, Matthew 25. Apocalyptic means something that's outstanding, sensational. It's going to happen. Watch out. The apocalypse, you know. Something's happening, going to happen, and be careful. And that judgment is based on doing the will of God. Final judgment means separation of good from evil. Much apocalyptic imagery about heaven or hell. Rohr says no mention of the word hell in Mark, John, and Paul. You will not see the word in those authors. In particular, Matthew's parables in particular underscore necessary decisions and the required actions that must characterize the followers of Jesus. So it's like, I'm laying the law down, this is it, you've got to do this. If you want to be a follower, you've got to do this and this and this and this. There's not much mysticism in Matthew like you find in John. John talks about, I'm the vine, you're the branches, live on in me, remain in me and I in you. If you love me, keep my commandments, I am love. This is John, very mystical. You don't see that in Matthew. Matthew's kind of in your face, this is the law, you got to do this. But it is a love relationship. But it's not as kind of mystical as John. Does that make sense? Okay. I love John's gospel. I really do. There's a new talk out by Richard Rohr called Hell No. All right. And you could get it if you went to Google Hell No and then Richard Rohr, and you can probably, it comes right up. But I've listened to it 2 or 3 times. And it's really powerful because he mentioned such things as, okay, Jesus says you shall forgive your neighbor how many times? 70 times 7, you know. And all of a sudden, the Jesus after death is the different Jesus that's going to judge you. What about this Jesus that said forgive? And then this judge that you have in Matthew 25 is, there's no forgiveness here, this is it. You're going to heaven or hell, right? So it's like, wait a minute, what happened to the Jesus that was living and didn't condemn the woman that was caught in adultery, forgave her, you know, and everything? And all of a sudden we have this, that's why I think that Matthew 25 is a parable. It's not consistent with the other teachings. It's meant to scare you into submission and into doing what they want.
Is the rich man and Lazarus, is that only in Matthew also?
You know, I meant to copy out the all the parables and...
it's okay. I just wondered because that's the same theme there that the rich man didn't care about the poor Lazarus.
That's right.
He ends up in hell.
Right. I wish I had brought that. I'll have to get it for you. If you want, give me your email and I'll send you that that thing. You know?
Norma will give it. She's the email expert.
The email expert. All right. But there's a comparison of all the parables. I think Luke has more than anyone. I think Luke has around 18. Mark has around 15. John has hardly any. The parables of mercy are found in Luke, which really is consistent, as we'll see. The lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son, the prodigal son, that's all in Luke. Okay. We continue with the themes of the parables of Matthew. Okay, who's going to read this for me?
Okay,
Edward, okay.
Okay, go ahead.
Of the parables of Matthew. A, word parable occurs 15 times in Matthew. B, Matthew adapted many parables from Mark. C, parables are unique to Matthew.
No, the parables that are unique to Matthew, that only Matthew has, in other words.
Okay. Parable of the wheat and the weeds, the treasure buried in the field, the pearl, the dragnet, and the scribe of the kingdom.
Okay.
D, often include a combination of action and dialogue, imaginative and reverential language, apocalyptic scenarios, and allegory. E, dramatic parables where human decisions invite listeners and readers to identify and judge themselves.
Okay. I think I pointed out before that the word parable comes from the Greek para, let's see, I think something like this, I can't remember. But it literally means alongside of, throw something alongside of something else to compare them. That's the literal meaning of the word parable. Something that's thrown along someone, along something else to compare it. It's like a metaphor or a simile, you know, in your study of literature. Similes use the words like or as. A tree is like a, you know, whatever. And the poem, Nothing is Lovely as a Tree That Looks at God All Day. Remember Joyce Gilmer's? And a metaphor is something that is comparison, but it leaves out the words like or as. But it's they're implied. So all religion is metaphorical language. Because we don't have direct language with God. I mean, we only do that in deep prayer and contemplation. So everything is metaphorical. It's always like this. You ever hear the youth today talking? Every other sentence is like. Like I went to school one day, and like I saw someone else, and like she told me this. And I don't know where they got that habit, but it just drives you nuts sometimes when you're listening to them, you know? You ever notice that? I don't know where that started, but it's the way to speak now. And it's all simile, okay? So once again, Matthew is calling for a decision for Christ. The parable of the wheat and the weeds, you remember that? The guy comes up to the owner of the field and says, Master, someone sowed weeds in our wheat overnight. What do we do? Do we pull them all up? What did the master say? Let them grow together. And then at the harvest, we'll separate them, you know? To separate the wheat from the chaff. Uh-huh. This idea of separation of good and evil. But I think we need to realize that this constant talk about separation of good from evil is basically Plato. Plato, the Greek philosopher, was into dualism, which is one or the other, black or white, right or wrong, good or bad, you know, not much gray matter in between. It's either or. And Matthew is a lot of that. John, on the other hand, is more both and than either or. That's why he's the mystical contemplative one, you know. But Matthew wants a decision. The pearl, the treasure buried in the field. What's that about? You found this great treasure in the field, you sell everything and you buy that field. It's all or nothing. Go for it, you know. The pearl, a great price. Sell everything and get that pearl. It's make a decision. All right, we're going to continue with Matthew. Shows a love of extravagance or exaggeration. A shrub in Mark becomes a tree in Matthew. The treasure and pearl exceed all value. The talents given to the servants equal wages from 30, 60, and 150 years. I mean, it was just unheard of. he exaggerated all over the place, way beyond any kind of amount that they can even imagine. Matthew's parables not only reflect conflicts with outsiders, they are also used as warnings to the community. For example, the parable of the lost sheep, an exhortation to care for the straying little ones in the community. The unmerciful servant serves as a paradigm of the unlimited forgiveness that is to characterize community members, especially leaders. Now, once again, you compare this particular theme of Matthew's parables with the judgment in the Matthew 25. And is it to be taken literally? I don't think so. I think it's a parable. So I think what the main gist of the parable of the last judgment is to be aware of what you do to the least of my brothers and sisters you do to me. I was hungry, you gave me to eat. I was in prison, you came to visit me. I was sick and you came to see me. You know, it's identification with Christ, all right? And if you don't, then you are outside of this awareness of the body of Christ. You are an autonomous person, not connected, separated. And so that separation means this weeping and gnashing of teeth. It's an exaggerated symbol that gets across the idea that you are refusing to recognize that Christ is in each person. You want to live as if they're not. You want to label them so you can kill them justifiably. Well, I mean, he was a no good son and such, and he deserved to die, you know. That's the way we have to do it if we're going to kill someone. We have to label them out of relationship. Any questions on that? Is it making sense? I hope.
Yes.
Okay. It's not easy stuff, all right? Okay, let's go into the themes of Luke. That's one of Kelly's favorite little transition things there. Who's going to read that? Themes of Luke.
I will.
Okay, Darlene, yeah.
First, whereas Matthew was writing for a predominantly Jewish Christian audience, Luke was a Gentile writing for Gentile Christians. Like Mark, Luke has Jesus on the way to Jerusalem from Galilee, but also has Jesus earnestly instructing his followers along the way. 2, Luke focuses on Christology and discipleship. Luke wrings some of the mystery out of Mark's identity of Jesus. 3, Jesus is a sage speaking wisdom and a prophet, with his disciples as witnesses to the prophet's message. And 4, ministry of Jesus is expressed in hospitality, forgiveness, and universalism, the inclusion of all.
Okay, once again, this is the theme of Luke, inclusion, mercy, forgiveness, compassion. You know, not so much this is the law, you must obey it in Matthew. You know, there's a different flavor. Luke focuses on Christology and discipleship. What does it cost to be a follower of Jesus? And Matthew's more focusing on is Jesus the Messiah or not? If so, then you've got to follow him. There are a lot of things in common, but it's a different nuance. Okay, high cost of discipleship. That's another theme of Luke. Need for perseverance along the way. You know, if you want to save your life, you have to lose it. If you want to, live, you've got to die. These are perseverance things. Luke's view of the disciples is multifaceted and more positive than Mark's. So both Matthew and Luke have given a more positive description of the disciples than Mark did. And Mark is where Luke and Matthew together represent 93% of what the Gospel of Mark is. So you see, Mark was written first. That was the first Gospel. And Luke and Matthew took a lot from Mark, a lot. whereas Mark doesn't have very much in common with Matthew and Luke. Okay, special Lucan themes. Who's going to read that here?
The importance of repentance and the reversal of this world's values. In Jesus' concern for the poor, the outcast, the disenfranchised, he reveals the God of mercy and compassion. Stress the dangers of wealth and self-importance. The defenseless are vindicated and the complacent challenged. Prayer, joy, and praise themes.
Okay, those run throughout. You know, teach us how to pray and so forth. You'll see a lot of the dangers of wealth, a lot of the parables about wealth, like the lives, the dives and the rich man and the beggar, dives and the Lazarus. It's very, you know, there's more in the gospel about wealth and poverty and our use of money, much more so than anything about sexual morality. And yet, what is the church focused on? Morality and sex. For one thing, I mean, to be a little cynical about it, whenever you talk about your body and sexuality, people are more easily shamed than it would be about how do you use your money, right? And so there can be an element of control in here and threat and keeping people in line, okay, and people keeping people fear-based and shame-based. And that's not what Jesus came for, but the church is also human and can devolve into this particular framework. So, okay, Luke's parables are realistic, not allegorical, as are many in Matthew. Believers are faced with the decision and the challenge to convert today, here, and now. That's similar to Matthew also. Luke is less interested in apocalyptic eschatology, like the whole idea of the Last Judgment, than in demonstrating the timeless presence of the reign of God. The kingdom of God is now. Large crowds are mostly positive in their response to Jesus in the Gospel of Luke, and Luke involves Jesus' listeners. What do you think about this? He engages them in a conversation. Luke does. Okay, now we get to the essence of it. What's the meaning of this parable? Banquet is a symbol of God's desire and hunger for unity and happiness. This is all my particular, a lot of this other stuff was from the scripture scholars. This is my take.
That's you?
This is me, yeah, right. A banquet is a symbol, you know, just like the Garden of Eden is a symbol. You know, it wasn't a particular garden. It's a symbol of happiness and joy, especially in any kind of a desert country. A garden and oasis and everything is life-giving. This is a symbol of God's wanting everybody to be one, that all may be one, that we find in John 17. We notice in both of the parables of Luke and Matthew, they want the banquet to be full. They don't want three people when you fix food for 50, right? That's why they say, go out and compel people to come in. I was reading, it's an interesting thing, that the Mideasterners have this custom. They like to be sort of coerced into coming in, you know? They put up resistance. Oh, we want you to go. Oh, I don't think I can. Oh, and they keep after you, badger you. Okay, well, fine. They like that. It helps them feel like they're really wanted. If you just say, hey, can you come to the banquet? They say, well, I'm busy. Well, too bad. I'll go to someone else. No. They want to go back and forth. It's just like they like to barter over or things they're selling in the Mideast, you know. They'll give you a price, and you counteract, and you come back, and 15, no 10, no 12, no 11. I mean, you finally get a price, you know. This is the Mideastern way of doing things. And so a banquet is a symbol of unity. You could only eat with certain people, but it's this desire of God to all be one. Invitation means the respect for the ones invited to say yes or no. It was always an invitation. They were invited. They were not told, you've got to show up at this time or else. The or else came when they said yes and then they didn't show up and then they got it. That was Matthew. But Luke also says that the owner, one giving the banquet got angry. Both of them say that, you know. Okay. Now then you get into the universalism. Origen, one of the great patristic writers, taught in the Eastern Church more than in the Western, the whole theme of apokatakasis. It's a big Greek word, apokatakasis, which means universal salvation, coming from, I think, Revelations 3, I think it is. Let me see. That all will be saved. Okay. Now, this was a teaching of the early church, but it has really gotten into, how many times have you heard that? That everybody will eventually be in heaven. Revelation. I had it written here somewhere.
You said, did I misunderstand you? You said everyone will eventually be in heaven?
Well, this is what universalism is. Universalism, apokatakasis.
Oh, okay.
That's the teaching.
That teaching.
And it's not been preserved through the years, but it's more in the Eastern Church than the Western Church. But I know I wrote it down here somewhere. Anyway, I think it's Revelations, Book of Revelations, the last book in the Bible. I can't find it right now. But anyway, this has never been condemned by the church. Now, this teaching says that after you die, we've all been taught, well, you've only got until you die. And then after that, well, it's heaven or hell, right? You got to do something now. Universalism, apokatakasis, says that if that were the case, death would be stronger than God. Who's to say that God cannot continue to woo us into union even after death? Now, we always need to, in order to keep it orthodox, we need to always keep in mind that it's free will. We have the choice to say yes or no to God. That it's got to be there, because otherwise there's no such thing as forced love. It's a square circle. You cannot force someone to love you. It's got to be free, right? So, God, we always have the free will to say yes or no to God's invitation, but this universalism teaches that God will continue to seek after us and woo us until we finally give up and we accept God's love. You know, I believe this. I am a great believer in apokatakasis. I think that God is not limited by death, and that after death, God will continue to give us, for all eternity, woo us into union, until there will be one heaven and one earth, as the book of Revelation says. A new heaven and a new earth.
Father, when did you say this universalism? Origen
was the patristic father, and it was very common. He was only one of many patristic fathers that taught this.
And when was that?
Origen lived around the second century, I think it was. Yeah. So it's been a favorite teaching in the church for years, and somehow or another, we have gotten more into judgment and fear, and everything else, rather than this confidence that God's mercy will win over everyone. So, I mean, you can choose to accept what you want. I'm just telling you where I stand. Anybody have any preferences?
I feel that I feel Judas will be in heaven.
No.
I do.
Well, I mean, there's some people say, well, if Hitler's there, I don't want to be there, you know, or Stalin or whoever, you know. So.
Who are we?
Well, I know. I know. But I mean, some people like to talk about hell because they want certain people to go there.
Well, we may be. Maybe you said this, Father. We may be surprised to see who's up there.
Oh, of course.
I mean,
how many of us throughout our lives say, well, you know, this guy's got it okay now, but he's going to get it later, you know, and you kind of relish the thought of people like that suffering in hell. But I mean, another image that you can use just out of common sense is, who can be happy for all eternity if one of their loved ones, their children, or whoever is in hell for all eternity? Can a mother be happy? Can a father? Can a brother? I mean, wait a minute. Is there no hope for change? With this teaching that after you, everything happens, has to take place until your last breath, and then after that, forget it. That's kind of grim. Myself, I don't like that. I don't think that's very gospel. Okay. So it's inclusion, not exclusion. Stretching our boundaries. Different approaches of Matthew and Luke invite us to look at how we invite others into what we experience as meaningful and fulfilling. Okay? Are we hospitable people? Are we inviting people? Are we exclusionary, you know, in our daily lives? So you could, if we had more time, we'd have a group discussion on what leaps off the page for us, okay? Okay, so that sort of wraps up this looking at the different versions of the Great Banquet Parable. Let me just get some feedback. What are you going to take home in your doggy bag? What's somebody who walks out the door and they say, oh, what did you talk about tonight, huh? What did you learn? What are you taking with you? What are you going to say?
That Matthew wasn't all wrong. It was, you know, how it was interpreted. You know, that. And they were all right in a certain sense.
Well, they each had their own particular flair, their own particular way of expressing it, right? Their individual personality, their individual goals and themes, and you just need to know that when you read it. So you think of something of fire and brimstone, you think, well, that's probably from Matthew, you know?
So if you, when this comes up in the cycle,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do they include that part about the guy who doesn't have the proper
yes,
garment?
That's always in there.
Do you just ignore that then in your homily, or is
I don't deal with that.
Oh, okay. Oh.
I just ignore it. And I'm more likely than not will just not even read that last.
Oh.
Not even read that last paragraph. Because it's a separate parable. It doesn't fit.
Because we were talking and we said, well, some Catholic friends would say, well, that's the guy that comes to church in jeans and a tank top. You know?
Shorts on, right?
Yes, right.
Yeah, right. Short shorts. They didn't do that when I was growing up, you know. We wore a tie and a coat, and, you know, we were hot as you know what, but we were correct, right? We had the proper wedding garment, you know. Well, and now anything goes.
But they're there.
They're there.
And if
right.
We are a community of people who are inviting and inclusive.
Exactly.
Then I'm just totally excited that everybody that comes into St. Mary's.
Right.
I think it's cool. I think it's really cool.
Yeah, right.
We have our Jimmy who carries
yes,
the
yes.
cross.
I know Jimmy, yes.
You know Jimmy.
Yeah, right, yeah.
And, you know, and I mean, he's so welcoming.
Oh, yes, he
he's
is.
He's so welcoming to everybody. And people, mostly, are very welcoming to
yeah,
him.
That's right.
And that's
yeah.
the way I think we should be.
Exactly, you know.
Yeah, we have quite an array of people at St. Mary's.
We sure do.
Yeah, right. Well, it's like what someone said about Catholicism. Well, here comes everybody. We have them all, don't we?
you know, when you're saying about, you know, hell.
Yeah.
It wouldn't make any sense, it wouldn't be fair to the teenager that lives, you know, a wild, crazy life and mm-hmm. gets killed in an automobile accident.
Yeah.
Compared to the man that lives to be 100
yeah.
and has all that time to repent.
Right. Yeah.
You know, there's no justice there. I mean,
well, it's like,
you know,
it's like the good thief. You know, here this guy lived this horrible life all his life, and at the very last minute, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Today you will be with me or die. And all these people say, you mean he gets in at the last minute? And I've sweated and toiled and went to synagogue and church all my life and kept all the commandments, and he gets in the same as I do? What is going on here? You know, that's what some of the parables deal with. Like, wherever we get to the parable of the just laborers, you know, the ones who are paid the same price that the people that worked all day long, and the guy that comes in the last hour gets the same wages. Remember that parable?
Yep.
Oh, a lot of people get upset with that. I don't like that parable. Mm-hmm. That's not fair. And they're judging it from the eyes of our own instead of God's mercy. God can do what God wants to do. God's God, right? Who are we to say? You can't let him in. He only got in at the last minute. I'm sorry.
But that's our judgment here.
That's our judgment. That's our judgmental stance.
Yeah.
Wow. This is very good. Thank you.
A lot of good stuff, right?
A lot of good stuff.
Okay. Well, good. Well, let's have a little closing prayer here, huh? Loving God, thank you for inviting all of us into your banquet, into your love, into your embrace, into union with you and with each other. Help us to learn how to live without judging one another, without judging ourselves, without judging you, so that we may have this kind of unity for which you came. Help us to live in such a way that we include all in our love and exclude no one. Bless all of us so that we may hunger for your word and your unity and your banquet, your Eucharist. Give us a safe trip home and a blessed night. Peace in our hearts. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.